Lord shall increase you more and more, you and your children. And then David wrote this in the next verse, Psalms 115, verse 14 and 15. He just said, you are blessed of the Lord who made the heavens and the earth. You are blessed of the Lord. That's who you are. I just prophesy over you, your sons and daughters of the Most High God. You are the redeemed of the Lord, redeemed by blood. You are changed. You are cleansed. You are made righteous, made holy through Jesus. Hear the word of the Lord. The Lord shall increase you.
Hallelujah.
I hear the Lord saying, I'm going to increase your sphere of influence. I'm going to increase your capability. I'm going to increase your faith. I'm going to increase your vision. I'm going to increase your anointing. The Lord shall increase you and your children. You are blessed of the Lord. So, Father, right now we thank you for the seed we hold in our hand, the tithe and the offering. We've been delivered from paying tithes. It's our desire to give tithe this morning, to plant seeds, to see your house prosper. Lord, I'm asking you to increase Open Door more and more. Open Door and its children, its sons and daughters, to increase Open Door more and more. Every way, in the natural, in the spiritual, in the financial, in the material, in the anointing, in property, every way. Every way. I just hear someone saying, what about the economy? Jesus said in Mark 11, 22, have faith in God. Well, what about my job? Have faith in God. What about the mess in Washington? Have faith in God. Have faith in God.
Hallelujah.
We receive it, Lord. And I thank you. This seed leaves our hand. This is the smallest my seed will ever be. This is the smallest it'll ever be, because you said your seed sown is multiplied. You said given it shall be given unto you. Good measure pressed down, shaken together. The Lord shall increase you. Running over shall men give back to you. So we receive it this morning. Thank you. It's with joy. It's with great joy and celebration we give and share. Thank you. Your house is blessed. Your people are blessed, Lord, as we love each other now. Thank you for your anointing. Thank you for your power and your wisdom on this church, on us, and on me today. In Jesus' name, we agree together and we said amen. All right, come bring your tithe and offering so liberally today. Let's believe God and then hug your neighbor, love somebody, and bless the people around you.
See you.
Be the glory. That's probably one of the best praise and worships we've had in the 21 years I've been here. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
I have to say the presence of God is thicker and richer right now than it's ever been. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
You just tuned in by internet. What you're experiencing, the presence of God is rich and full in this place. He's touching people's lives. The anointing's being poured out. The power of God is being demonstrated. And the glory of God is being revealed. So there's no need for you to miss out on it. Just go ahead and receive it. You that are watching by internet, just receive the glory of God. If you'll lift your hands and start praising Him, give Him glory. This same anointing that's in this room begin to flow over on you. It's healing your body. It's making you well. It's strengthening you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Give God the glory. That's what I hear. Give God the glory. Give God the glory. Give God the glory. Give God the glory.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
We give God the glory. Just receive whatever you need. Receive whatever you need. Receive whatever you need. Jesus. This morning, while I was taking communion, I experienced this extreme ringing in my left ear, just severe, and it lasted about 20 seconds, and I had the communion cup in my hand, and I stopped, and I said, in the name of Jesus, stop.
Yes, yes.
Now, and to God be the glory, immediately, if not sooner. Just like that ringing stopped. supernatural. It just stopped. God's good. God wants this to work on the highest level.
Yes.
God wants us to walk in the high places. In Jesus' name. All right. Tammy, come on, greet us real quick. Tammy wants to bless you. We've poured out to her all week and blessed her. We've been praying for you and you're strengthened today. So greet the people and just share what's on your heart.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. All glory and honor to our God. I just wanted to thank my Open Door family. Don't take it lightly. Your calls, your words of encouragement, your prayers, and your visits. I thank you. I truly thank you. I ask you not to take that lightly, because your presence was ministered to my family in their time of need. Because as I often say, there's no place like Open Doors. And for me to be know that I was undergirded by my fellow sisters and brothers in Christ kept me afloat. There was a sadness, but I wasn't weeping and mourning as if there was no hope. Because to do that within me being here today was just in vain. Because I profess to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. He was born, crucified, died, and buried, arose again, and ascended into the heavens. I thank God, you know, that he placed me and called me to the place of caring for my mother and father. That was a calling from God. And I often would say to many of you, and I say it to say that what God has ordered, he will pay for. Because a lot of times I wondered, how could I just not to just leave and just put all my time and effort and minister to my mother and my father. And he would always tell me to just consider the birds. And something Pastor would say would always resonate back to me. He said, if you be mindful of the things that concern God, he'll take care of the things that concern you. And he has kept us. He's keeping us. He's blessing us. And I just wanted to say thank you and that continue to pray for my family. Continue to pray for me and keep me lifted up in prayers. I know I prayed, and it was a calling for me to be there to minister. I was often crying out to the Lord because I felt a disconnect from my church family here. And he reminded me, he said, Tammy, you are the church. You go out and you minister to your mother and you minister to your family. And he allowed me to be salt and a light. And I had a witness. And in that time of caring for my mother, I was actually on the mission field. So keep my family lifted up in prayer, because as the Lord said in his word, that the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. And we're not going to just pray that souls be saved. We're going to pray and ask God that he send laborers. And I'm so excited. I'm so excited, and I'm living in a state of expectancy, just waiting to see what the Lord has next for me to do. And I thank you. Thank you, my Open Door family. Thank you.
Amen.
Just one more thing. Never, ever, ever. My pastor, John T. Cahill, has been a blessing to my family. He was able to partake in the services. Of course, you know, he held the services for my father, and people are still enlightened. And he was able to take part in the service of my mother. Never, ever, ever have I heard the gospel preached in 5 minutes. Pastor John, you know, it's a lot of them preaching and been preaching for decades and still hadn't preached the gospel. But Pastor John was able to bless the people and preach the gospel in 5 minutes. And I thank him.
Thank you. All of you know that's a supernatural miracle for me to preach 5 minutes. Yeah, but it happened. 5 minutes. 5 minutes. All right, Deborah has a financial testimony, and then we're going to get in the Word.
This is about giving. Y'all know that I got dismissed from my job in 2015 in November, and I didn't get any unemployment because I had restrictions on the injury that I had, and so I had quite a few wages that I had lost. And so I'd asked Pastor, I said, what to do? And he says, well, whatever you do, just don't be ugly about it. So I filed a civil suit against them for dismissing me with no notice. They didn't even let me finish my week, and I never railed on them, and somebody had told me, they said, well, they told us that you were dismissed and sent to another office. And I thought, no, they really fired me, but, you know, it's okay. And so in December, my attorney had a deposition set up for me, and he called me and had it lined up, and he says, well, it's been postponed till after the first of the year. And then he said they were going before the judge. Well, they went before the judge, and he said, I really don't think they're going to keep your case. It's not a real good case, and they're going to drop it. Well, they didn't. The judge didn't dismiss it. And so it put them in a position where they had to settle with me. And he said, well, what do you want? And I said, well, I want the full amount. And I said, ask them for the full amount. And he says, well, I don't know what we'll get, but we'll ask them for the full amount. So it was from November 15th till June the 1st. So he called me back a week later, and he said, well, guess what? He said, you're going to get the full amount. Now, that's God's faithfulness, and I didn't rail on them, and I wasn't unkind or ugly and didn't, you know, speak ugly about these people. But I just thank God. I mean, he said, I wasn't expecting that, and I told him, I said, the Lord did that. And I said, I held my peace there, and I wasn't mean or ugly about the way that I was treated. And I said, I believe the Lord did that for me. And so I witnessed to my attorney about the Lord making a way. The other thing was about my children. My youngest middle son got his first job with three ENTs last fall. And he didn't know they were going to hire him. This was a surprise. This was after I prayed for him. And the Lord opened a door for him in Kalispell, Montana. And he told me what he made. They gave him $70,000, but he made $90,000 last year. That's what he cleared and brought home. And I am just thankful. I thought, wow, Lord. And I have seen the Lord take care of my children. So I just wanted to bear witness with what Pastor said with that.
All right, let's stand together. The Lord shall increase you more and more, and your children. You are blessed of the Lord. All right, to the board. Today at 4 o'clock is ladies' tea time. Please, ladies, be involved in that. Remember that. That's for all the ladies. Midweek service is Wednesday at 6:30. Our prayer service is Tuesday at 6 p.m. And asking everyone, when you get your taxes back, please sow a seed to help us get ahead during this time of the year, because the yard's coming up and all those extra expenses. And we thank God. And the tea party today is called You Are Valuable and Beautiful. Ladies, from 4 to 6 o'clock. All right? All invited. All right. Sunday, March 26th will be our World Missions Day, with missionary evangelists Curtis and Paula Silcox will be with us from Fayetteville, Tennessee, and they're going to bring us a great revelation. We'll have Sunday night service that day and have a marvelous time, so be in prayer about that. And we will be having evening service, and we're praying for Fred and Peggy Schiffbauer and family this week. All right, Mr. Fred, pray for Fred. Amen. And we're believing God for them. Praise God. All right, let's say it together. We're a family church, a Bible training center. We're changing Lancaster, South Carolina, and we're excited about Jesus. Our vision is Jesus Christ. Our mission is to preach, teach, and exalt the Lord Jesus Christ in all the fullness of His glory and power, and to radiate His love to our community and unto all the world. Amen. All right, let's agree. Father, thank You. We have Your word. And with great reverence and respect, we hold Your word dear and high esteem. We open it with great reverence today. Thank You. As we open our Bible, it opens to us. Holy Spirit, You're the teacher of the church. You reveal and unveil the gospel, the new covenant, our Lord Jesus, Him enthroned, Him empowered to be the blessing to us. We thank You that every need is met. We thank You that You're working, planting deep seed within us, a seed deep within us. And I thank You, Your seed brings forth good fruit, not 30, not 60, but 100-fold. And I hear it again, the Lord shall increase you and your children yet more and more. And you are blessed of the Lord. We receive it. We receive the spirit of increase. Jesus increased in wisdom, stature, and favor. Paul said you are increasing with the increase of God in Colossians 2, 19 and 20. So this seed is increasing us, and we thank You for it. You're multiplying us. You're blessing us. And we agree together in Jesus' name. Bless the children, young people now, and we thank You for it. And in agreement, we said together, amen. All right, children, young people, you may go. And if you're in the auditorium, you can open with me for time's sake, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We are rejoicing together in the person and work of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is good. You're blessed today. Now, let me go further. You're blessed of the Lord. Now, we just had a wonderful time in praise. We shouted and danced, but remember what I taught you? Indians, remember about the Indian? We don't go from Comanche Indian to Wooden Indian. We're believing God for good things. Honored to have you this morning. God is good. God is faithful. You are blessed of the Lord. And we are sounding these trumpets of healing and strength. And today, for time's sake, I'm going to dispense with a lot of review. I'll just make mention of these trumpets, and then we will get into 1 Corinthians 12 and the book of James chapter 5. These healing trumpets must sound in the church. A glorified body comes at the last trump, according to 1 Corinthians 15. We shall be changed at the last trumpet. So there are preceding trumpets. If you have a last trumpet, you must have preceding trumpets. You can't have a last of anything if you don't have a first and a middle. It's first, middle, last. So we started sounding these trumpets, and this goes in our series of Heirs of God, Joint Heirs with Christ, that we are rejuvenated and have a right to what Abraham and Sarah had in their physical body. We have a right to that to work in us. And it's never too late and it's never too early to start believing God for healing, health, and strength. In our day, there are young people dying from dread diseases. There are young people that are hurting and broken. So it's never too early. It's never too late to start believing God for healing, health, and strength. I started learning these things when I was 24 years old because of Anthony. My son was born very sick. So I was forced to healing because I was 24 years old and I pastored a very young church anyway. We didn't have anybody sick in the church much at all. Then healing was not my passion or my thought. But when Anthony was born sick, I had to get Anthony some help. So that's what drove me into this healing word, and now it's served me. And we've been able to help many, many people be at least restored to some measure of health and to get their healing and to get strength and to learn how to walk in healing, health, and strength. So trumpet number one sounds when we sound the trumpets. God never changes. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Trumpet number two sounds. God made the first man without sickness, disease, death, or decay in his body. Trumpet number three sounds. Disease came into the earth through Adam's transgression. It was not God's plan, not his design, not his desire, but it was Adam's transgression. Adam's transgression caused disease and sickness to be in the earth. Trumpet number four sounds. Sickness and disease was strategically placed under the curse, so God could put the curse on Jesus and take it off of you. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. And trumpet number five sounds, the old covenant's filled with healing. I am the Lord that healeth thee. I will take away from thee all sickness. Deuteronomy 7:15. I will bless thy bread and water, and I will take sickness from thee, listen, and the number of thy days I will fulfill, and none of you shall miscarry. Praise God. That's the word of the Lord, the old covenant. Then Christ Jesus came, trumpet number six sounds, and he is healing in manifestation. Jesus is the will of God in action. Jesus is the manifestation of God's plan and God's purpose. He's the embodiment of God. He's the express image of his person, Hebrews 1:3. And so whatever Jesus is, the Father is. So healing flowed freely in the ministry of Jesus. And you could spend a lifetime learning and looking at what Jesus did in the healing ministry. And then we notice Jesus, number seven, sounds and the trumpet sounds, and Jesus took stripes on his back for your healing. Trumpet number eight sounds, he was resurrected from the dead, and healing is in the life side. You see, he took stripes and bled and suffered on the death side, but when he was raised from the dead, with his stripes were healed. And the word with is a preposition that denotes a simultaneous action. So when his stripes were healed, that's when God released healing to humanity. Everyone's healing that ever comes through the gospel is released through Jesus being raised from the dead. Then Jesus was exalted far above all principality and power, including all sickness, disease, and death. Jesus is Lord over all sickness, disease, death. Jesus is Lord. He's exalted. And then the name of Jesus is glorified. And Jesus went into the heavens. Jesus, the mediator, the man between God and men, Christ Jesus, the man Christ Jesus, that man is in the heavens, but his healing ministry is here, for he left his name. And then to enforce his name, he sent his spirit. And the Spirit honors the name of Jesus. And it's all in the name of Jesus. And what a wonderful devotion we had this morning to exalt the name. How precious, how holy the name of Jesus. And you never waste time when you're exalting the name of Jesus. Honor the name of Jesus. No other name's given among men whereby we might be saved. So Jesus has given his name. Then Jesus gave the Great Commission, and in the Great Commission he said, "These signs shall follow them that believe. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." Not these signs will follow the preacher or the apostle, but these that believe. So your hands are healing hands, holy hands, and they are helping hands because of what happened to Jesus' hands. His hands were nailed to a tree and bled so that there could be the power of God resident in your hands. God wants to use your hands for his glory. God wants you to lay hands on the sick and believe they'll recover. Receive that? Then we looked at healing in the book of Acts. The trumpet sounds, and when Jesus ascended the heavens, the stream of healing began to flow. It flowed in Acts 3. It flowed in Acts 4. It flowed in Acts 5, Acts 6, Acts 8. It flowed in Acts chapter 14, chapter 19, and chapter 28. You'll find it flowing all the way through the book of Acts because the healing power of Jesus is evident and resident in the gospel we preach. Paul preached the gospel in Acts 14 to a man at Lystra, lame in his feet, perceiving he had faith to be healed, said, "Stand upright on thy feet." The man leaped up and was made whole. There's healing in the gospel we preach. Then we looked at healing in the epistles. And thank God, the new covenant has more healing than the old. Every time we see the name Jesus, there's healing. Every time we see mention of his suffering, his stripes, his seating, his sacrifice, his spirit, or his salvation, any one of those thoughts that run the thread of the theology of the new covenant, whether it be his sacrifice, his suffering, his stripes, his seating, it be his spirit or his salvation, wherever you see that, you'll find healing there. Like, for example, by grace are you saved. There's healing there. Saved means to be healed, delivered, preserved, blessed, kept alive. It means to be restored to health. So by grace are you saved. There's healing there. The new covenant's filled with healing. We just didn't know what to look for. We have a better covenant established on better promises. And then we sound this trumpet of the indwelling life of God. God lives in you. And your healing is not coming down from above. It's not coming back from the deep, as Paul said in Romans 10. Don't say who will go into the deep place or to the abyss to get him up. But what does the word of faith say? The word of faith is nigh you even in your heart and mouth, that if you will believe in your heart God raised you from the dead, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, you shall be saved. So healing lives in me. Healing lives in you. If the spirit of him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised Christ from the dead shall quicken your mortal body by his spirit that dwelleth in you. And then we looked at this trumpet. The trumpet sounded of prayer. Thank God for prayer. Thank God for the beauty of prayer. How important it is that we learn how to pray and how to believe God for what we pray. Jesus said, "Whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe you receive them, you shall have them." And I personally desire to be in health and walk in health and strength. I can testify now. I've been sick, very sick, and I've been very healed. I can tell you, heals better. I've been broke, and I've had money. I can tell you, money's better, just from experience. And you know, you don't have to be really that sharp to figure that out. You don't even have to be spiritual. All you got to do is live a while, and you'll figure that out. You know, I've been blessed, and I've been cursed. It's just better to be blessed. Just better all the way around. You can do more. You can help more people. There's so much more you can do. So thank God for answers to prayer. And then last week we sounded this final trumpet where we've come to in our study of the trumpet of faith. And it does matter what you believe. And so you want to be very prayerful about what you believe. You want to be very prayerful about what you set yourself in agreement with. I'm in agreement with the new covenant. I am new covenant. I'm in agreement with the Lord Jesus Christ in that throne. I'm in agreement with my seating. I'm in agreement with his word to me, over me, for me. I'm in agreement with what God says about him and me together. We're one spirit. I'm in agreement, and I am learning that this is non-negotiable. The controversy's ended, and this is the way it is. This is the way it is. And in this new covenant, listen to it. Jesus said now, and he was talking to a multitude and to his disciples, he said, "Listen, I want you to consider the sparrows. They don't sow they don't reap and they don't gather into barns. Now you see, you've got an advantage. God lets you sow, God lets you reap, and he'll also let you gather into barns. You've got an advantage over the sparrows. But Jesus said, your Father feeds them. Then Jesus said, now consider the lily, they don't toil or spin. But there's not a king with more glory than one of them. Even Solomon in his glory was not arrayed like one of them. And today they are, and tomorrow they're cut down and cast into the oven. Then Jesus said, oh, you of little faith. Not, oh, you of little giving. Not, oh, you of little prayer. Not, oh, you of little Bible study. Not, oh, you of little fasting or church attendance, but, oh, you of little faith. It matters what you believe. So I believe God. I believe what is written. I woke up every day this week. First thoughts were, Lord, today I set myself in agreement before I get out of bed to believe your word. It is written. I believe it. I'm going to speak. I'm in agreement with your word. What your word says, that's exactly what I believe. That's the way it is. Grant unto me boldness to speak your word by stretching forth your hand to heal. Grant me boldness to believe and to say. It does matter. So we grow from what the Bible calls no faith. The gospel's preached. We get born again. We come to this little faith. And then we move to faith in God. And then Jesus said of the Syrophoenician Canaanite and of the Roman soldier, they had great faith. And if you'll look in both places, all they had was faith in his word. Great faith is always born out of God's word. And you have your Bible. You have all access to the faith of God. You have your Bible. You can believe what God said. You can make a choice. I believe what God said. Whose report do you believe? And then the Holy Ghost in us energizes that faith so that we are able then to pray in the most holy faith, building ourselves in that most holy faith by the power of God. So the trumpet sounds. Can you hear? In the Gospels, Jesus kept saying, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. In the Revelation, Jesus said 7 times, he that hath an ear. As we go, we grow. Your ears must become an ear. There's one sound I listen for. I know his voice. There's one sound that I listen for, his word. There's one sound that I listen for, that's him. God has removed the duality from my ears, and when I'm listening to things that are not him, it doesn't take long for me to distinguish the difference between what's him and not him, because he is so clear, so pure, so holy, and it just brings faith. When you hear him, you can't help but believe. Praise God. Now this morning, we're going to sound number 17 and 18. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the gifts of the Spirit are in the church, and we're the church. Now let's read here in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. You know you were Gentiles, carried away into these dumb idols, even as you were led. Wherefore I give you to understand, no man speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus cursed. No man can say Jesus is the Lord, but by the Holy Ghost. Now, therefore, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit, differences of administration, but the same Lord. There are diversities of operation. It's the same God which worketh all in all. So it's God working in you to will and do his good pleasure. It's the same God working in all, working all. So he's at work in every one of us. Now, listen to this. The manifestation of the Spirit. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. So let's just take a moment and receive that right now. Thank you, Lord. I receive the manifestation of the Spirit that's given to me. And what does he say? To profit withal. That means the manifestation of the Spirit of God is here to profit you spiritually, mentally, physically, socially, financially. It's here to bless you. To profit withal means you just prosperous. God's word, I believe what God said. 1 Corinthians 12:7, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to open door to every one of you to profit withal. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man. So notice the Spirit's given to every man, and the Spirit divides these gifts how? Severally to every man as he wills. Now, let's just take a few moments. This trumpet needs to sound, because we believe in the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit. Everything Jesus did for you is in the past tense. Jesus shed his blood 2,000 years ago. Jesus died 2,000 years ago. He was made a curse 2,000 years ago. Jesus rose from the dead 2,000 years ago. He entered the heavens 2,000 years ago. He sprinkled his blood on the mercy seat 2,000 years ago. Everything Jesus did for you is in the past tense. And you're 2,000 years removed from what he did in time. And the only thing that can make that relevant to you now and make that work now is the Holy Spirit. It's not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. So if we're not acquainted with the work, the ministry, the operation, the leading, guiding, direction, the unction, the teaching ministry of the Holy Ghost, then we are going to greatly lack, because what Jesus did won't work apart from the Spirit. It's the Spirit that quickens your body. It's the stripes that he uses to heal your body, but it's the Spirit that quickens your body. So we have to have some revelation, understanding, and knowledge. And as we walk with God, we should all learn to go more and more by the Spirit. To be led by the Spirit is to make right moves. The Holy Spirit don't do dumb stuff. People do dumb stuff. To make right moves at the right moment. Because there's a time in the natural, there's just certain times you need to do things when God tells you to. Because timing is crucial there in some things. Some things, if you miss God, if God tells you to go pray for somebody and you don't do it, you come back to pray for them later, you may have missed an opportunity. Now, God can still work by your faith, but there are places of the supernatural that open up when you obey God instantly. Quench not the Spirit. And I've probably lost a lot in my lifetime by quenching the Spirit. Because you have thoughts like, why should I go pray for him? He'll reject me. We've all done that. Right move, right moment, right motive. God's always dealing with the heart. Why do we do the things we do? We're led by the Spirit of God. So, very quickly this morning, this trumpet sounds. Paul makes it very clear to the church, I don't want you ignorant of spiritual gifts. Now, just let me make a bold declaration. Ignorance is on a rampage in the church. Ignorance is not hard to find in the church. And it don't matter what subject we bring up, you'll find that the church is vastly occupied by the spirit of ignorance. If we bring up the subject of salvation, if we bring up the Lord Jesus Christ, if we bring up the subject of healing, if we bring up the subject of faith, you'll find out that ignorance is on a rampage in the church. But Paul said, I don't want you ignorant. And the Holy Ghost wrote that through Paul. So if the Holy Ghost said through Paul, I don't want you ignorant of spiritual gifts, I can't think of a more empty subject than the gifts of the Spirit where the church is concerned. How many church people, if you walked up to them and said, tell me the 9 gifts of the Spirit, wouldn't have any idea what that is. Tell me how they operate. Tell me how they work. So there's a massive ignorance concerning the gifts of the Spirit. And the only way to overcome the ignorance is to open our Bibles and let God teach us. In the discourse to 1 Corinthians and to the first letter of the Corinthian church, the Apostle Paul said, there are those that occupy the room of the unlearned. And the room of the unlearned is a place where there are things you don't know. But that room has a door on it. And that door was opened 2,000 years ago when Jesus rose from the dead, and you've been given a spirit of wisdom and revelation. You don't have to stay in the room of the unlearned. You can walk out of that room and begin to occupy the room of the Lord. My people, Hosea 4:6, are destroyed for lack of knowledge. But let's finish the verse. They're destroyed for lack of knowledge because they reject it. You'll never be destroyed for what you don't know. You'll only be destroyed for what you reject. I don't know if I believe that. Just believe what God said. Do yourself a favor. Just pick up your Bible and believe it. You'll never be destroyed for what you don't know. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge because they reject it. I mean, how could you possibly hold a child accountable for what he don't know and punish him for what he doesn't know? There's no way you could do that. There's some things Reese don't know. What if I set her down and said, listen, honey, if you don't know your times tables all the way up through 12 by this afternoon at 6, I'm going to whip you. Would that be fair to Reese? No, because she doesn't know that. It's not time nor place for her to learn her times table. Now, when she gets into high school, she'll have to know her times tables. And I won't be the one whipping her, but Her mom and dad might, if she don't know her timetables by then. But see, it wouldn't be fair. But there are a few things that Reese does know, and she gets in trouble if she rejects it. Like, she knows you don't take your cup of chocolate milk and throw it out the table. When you're eating, you don't throw it off the table. She knows that. Now, she rejects that knowledge. That's going to cause some problems. That's going to get a pow-pow. See, that's rejecting knowledge. So God doesn't want you to be ignorant about spiritual gifts. Number two, you'll notice that there's idolatry is always available to the gullible. Now, at some point, God wants you to wise up and size up. I want to be very clear this morning. It takes a fool to follow a fool. It takes a fool to follow a fool. Notice what he says there. He says, now listen, you know you were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols. As you were led, somebody carried them away to dumb idols. Now let's just be very clear. God's on his throne this morning. Jesus is Lord. The Holy Ghost is here, and we have no room for idolatry. Jesus is Lord. And any time that we allow ignorance to remain, ignorance is always a root system of idolatry which comes to people that are gullible. You cannot operate in unbelief and not get in trouble. Unbelief causes you to depart the living God. Hebrews chapter 3. He warned us, lest an evil heart of unbelief be in you to depart the living God. You always step backwards when you're unbelieving. God's called you to faith. And it takes somebody that's gullible to move away from what God said. Jesus is Lord. I was 18 years old. I went to a Bible study in my hometown of Roanoke, Virginia. And there was a man there teaching, and this is what he said about his Bible. He said, you know, I've outgrown my Bible. I'm a living epistle. I've outgrown it. And so when I went up to him after the Bible study was over, I asked him for some scriptures, and he said, well, you won't find what I'm teaching in that thing. And he called this a that thing. And so I looked at him and I said, I'll be back after I learn that thing, because I don't know my Bible well enough to listen to you. Well, after I started learning my Bible, I figured out what a manifested fool he was. Just a manifested fool. I mean, he had certified papers. The very idea you think you've outgrown this, too big for your britches. I look back on that now and just blush with shame. I was dumb enough to go when I was 18. I listened to it once, but something in me just told me that wasn't right. Something in me told me that wasn't right. That was the Spirit of God telling me that's not right. So we don't ever want to be gullible. We want to believe what God said. Don't take my word for it. Check it out. If I tell you Ephesians 4:6 says there's one God, Father above all, through all, in you all, open your Bible and read it for yourself. If I tell you the Lord is your shepherd, you shall not want, open Psalms 23 and read it. If I tell you Jesus kept the law, fulfilled the law, you can find that in Romans chapter 8. It's all over the book. I want you to be in agreement with the book. You don't need to be gullible. You need to believe what God said. We are without excuse because we have a Bible and we have the Holy Ghost. And you're without it too. So you can't blame it on the church. You can't blame it on anybody else. You've got a Bible. You need to know what you believe and why you believe it. What I believe is the fruit. Why I believe it is the root. And God wants you to have root and fruit. Why I believe what I believe. And I believe the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise God. Then here he gives you some instruction in the grace, in the government, and in the glory of God, in the Spirit working in the church. Now notice this. First of all, when the Spirit of God's in operation, here's just some simple guidelines. The first guideline is the Lord Jesus will always be glorified. If the Spirit of God is working, Jesus will always be glorified. To God be the glory, and Jesus is glorified in this church. When we preach, we point to Him. When we minister, we point to Him. Look unto Jesus today. Jesus is always glorified. And He tells you no one can speak less of Jesus than what God says by the Holy Ghost. Now, Jesus was made a curse, but that's only in connection to the cross, and that's written in Galatians 3:13. To speak of Jesus in any lesser dimension, in any way or any form, at any time is wrong. God will never honor that. The Holy Ghost always glorifies Jesus. And we must say boldly, Jesus is the Lord. I love to say, Jesus is Lord over Open Door. Jesus is Lord over me. He's Lord over my family, my church, my home. He's Lord over my possessions. He's Lord over my finances. Jesus is my Lord. He's the Lord of heaven and earth. But Jesus is my Lord. And I say that by the Holy Ghost. And I add 1 John 4:15 to that. Whosoever shall confess Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he dwelleth in God. The Lordship of Jesus is always glorified. the lordship of Jesus is glorified, then the leadership of God in government and in grace and in glory is always prevalent. Now notice he said there are administrations, there are operations, and there are manifestations of the Spirit. Which one do we need? All three, because it's a threefold cord. Administration is the government of the Holy Ghost. Operation is the grace of the Holy Ghost. And manifestation is the glory of the Holy Ghost. Administration means that God will raise up leaders and operate through leaders. God gives you spiritual leaders to help you and to bless you. He gave the fivefold ministry. Then operations are grace. Operations are the removing of unwanted growth. Operations are for two things: removing growth and realignment. When a surgeon operates on you, it's either one or two reasons. He's realigning you with health, or he's removing something out of your body that doesn't need to be there. Now, the operations of the Spirit, they demand grace. The operations of the Spirit are very delicate. When God operates, he does it through skilled people that he's trained, because when you take the Bible and put it in the hands of someone who wants to mutilate or castrate instead of circumcising Mark, you get problems. So operates, that's a very delicate part. Sometimes God has to operate on the heart. You come in here and you got some things wrong in your heart, and God reaches out and just cuts flesh away, cuts flesh out of ears. It's very delicate, but operations are part of the Holy Ghost. And thank God for every time he's ever operated on me. Thank God for every time he realigns me. Thank God for every time he removes some things out of my life that don't need to be there. That's part of this journey. You can't just bypass operations, because there it is. There are operations of the Holy Ghost. And we've all had the Lord operate on us and realign us and remove some things. There's been bitterness. There's been anger, frustration. There have been different things, and they have to be removed because they hinder you. And God doesn't want you hindered. He wants you walking free. And then comes the manifestation, which is the glory of God, which is the demonstration and the tangible evidence of the Holy Ghost and power. And he does that. There are three gifts that reveal something. There are three gifts that do something, and three gifts that say something. So God wants to show you, God wants to do, and then God wants to speak to you. That's what the Holy Ghost is for. You see it? Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discerning of spirits. Three gifts that show you something. You can see what kind of spirit somebody's operating in. Remember, Jesus said to James and John, you don't know what spirit you're of. You don't know what spirit you're of. You need to know what spirit somebody's of. There's a lot of con and deception comes by the very fact of what people operate in. There are spirits that operate in and through people. Hear me this morning. Principalities operate through personalities. Then there are three gifts that do something: the working of miracles, the gift of faith, and notice the gifts of healings, which is our subject. The gifts of healings are in the Spirit. And where's the Spirit? The Spirit's in you, and the Spirit's in the church. So the gifts of healing are in the church. And they operate, and they minister, and they manifest God's glory to those that are sick and hurting in their body to heal them and bless them. That's part of the ministry of the Spirit of God. And that's never been done away with. Thank God that's part of the ministry of the Spirit of God. And then there are three gifts that say something. The first two gifts, tongues and interpretation, in a public assembly, if there's a tongue, there must be an interpreter, or Paul gave very clear instruction, then let the person speaking in tongues pray to himself, or either pray he interpret, but go no further. It's very clear. And then prophecy, which we had prophecy this morning, which was the word of exhortation, and prophecy is to exhort, to edify, and to comfort. And we had the word of exhortation on several fronts this morning. Sister Deborah gave a word, Brother Thomas gave a word, Sister Bev gave a word, and exhorted us, comforted us, ministered to us. And if you listen, it'll always line up with the Word of God. It'll always line up with Scripture. It'll bless, edify, and comfort. So here's the thought this morning. This trumpet sounds. These gifts of healing are in the church to help us and to make whole, and they complete us, and we need the gifts of the Spirit. Let me go one step further. This is where we all have to take a step of faith. God wants you to operate in the gifts of the Spirit. These are not for the preacher. They're given to every man to profit withal. Now notice how liberally the Spirit of God gives the gifts. Notice the Spirit's manifestation is given to who? To every man. And he divides to every man. So thank God right now in the name of Jesus, and I was praying over you last night, that you operate in the gifts of the Spirit, and at any moment, any time, God can work any one of these gifts through you to bless people and to meet their needs. I boldly speak over you. You operate the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, and the discerning of the spirits. You operate in the gift of faith. You see, you take your faith as far as it'll go. And there are some places where your faith will reach a limitation. But then there's a gift of faith where God puts his faith in you. And then anything is possible. Anything is possible. Anything can be done. Any miracle, any sign, any wonder can be worked by the gift of faith. Gifts of healing operate in you when you lay hands on people. Working of miracles operate in you. Praise God. Just think about it. What a miracle. I preached 5 minutes last Sunday afternoon. What a miracle. That's the working of miracles. Praise God. And got the gospel in 5 minutes. Praise God. Gifts of healing, working in miracles, tongues and interpretation. Any one of you, I'm believing God that many of you in the days and weeks to come will give out a public tongue and give an interpretation in the assembly. God wants this for you. But here's the problem. We've been afraid of it. We've been afraid of it because of what others think and what they're going to think. We've been afraid of it. And you're never going to operate anything where God's concerned that you're afraid of. Because fear holds us back. I'm not ashamed of the Holy Ghost. I'm not ashamed of the work of the Holy Ghost. I'm not ashamed of what happened here this morning. I thank God that we had some physical signs and tangible signs. People shaking under the power of God. Thank God we had some evidence of the Holy Ghost. We don't want to get to the place where we get so cold and indifferent. We think our knowledge is enough. Knowledge without the Holy Ghost is still just that. It's knowledge. You need the Spirit of God. Don't be ashamed of the Holy Ghost. Don't be afraid of the Holy Ghost. The Bible tells you, desire spiritual gifts. The Bible tells you to covet earnestly the best gifts. And if we go against that, we go against the Word of God. God wants you. And you can't just stand back for your fear. If you've got fear, admit it. Say, Lord, I'm afraid to operate in these things. And then let God help you step out. And I'm believing God for me. I'm believing God for you. I'm believing God for us. I'm believing God for we as the church, we as a family, to start moving into much greater dimension of this operation of the Spirit, because people's lives are changed by the Holy Ghost. People are convicted of their sin when they don't know Jesus. They're born again through the Holy Ghost. People get healed through the Holy Ghost. People are anointed by the Holy Ghost. People prophesy by the Holy Ghost. And what we need is a good breath and a good wind of the Holy Ghost to come in this church and just shake us and move us out of our complacency into a place where we're moving in the Spirit, led by the Spirit, fed by the Spirit, anointed by the Spirit, quickened by the Spirit, raised in the Spirit, breathing in the Spirit. We need the Holy Ghost. Let me go further. You need the Holy Ghost. Because you could sit in a church like this and get so full of knowledge, you get bigger and bigger in your head and smaller in your heart. You need the Holy Ghost. I need the Holy Ghost. Doesn't matter how much I know, I need the Holy Ghost. And these gifts are given. Let me give you one example. I was 19 years old. And we had had a former pastor from 1964 to 1968. And at that time, I was very, very little in 1964 to 1968. I was Johnny. And his name was Greer Hawkins. And we would get to church. And Brother Hawkins would often come in. We had an old annex building, which was a separate house. And I'd go in the annex where the kids were on Sunday morning. And oftentimes, Brother Greer Hawkins, he'd come up to me and he'd put his hand on my head and say, "Good morning, Johnny. Good to see you this morning. God loves you. Jesus loves you, Johnny." He put his hand on me and just walked on by. So I knew him that way. I knew him. And he left in 1968. Hadn't heard nor seen from him since. Now, this is in 1981. I'm going to preach at my home church. I just started preaching. Now, we had a man in my home church whose name was Thomas. Not this Thomas, another Thomas. His name was Thomas Coleman. And he had been in an accident where a tractor fell over on him and crushed him up here on this part of his body and had hurt him and wounded him. And he had had severe chronic headaches and neck aches, and had been going on for months and months and months in 1981. Well, because he was in the church when Greer Hawkins was there, he stayed friends with the pastor that left. Him and Brother Hawkins were good friends. And so I'm getting ready to preach on a Wednesday night, minding my own business. I'm just studying, preaching, I'm 19 years old, getting ready to go down there and preach. And Greer Hawkins calls Thomas Coleman and says, "I was praying this afternoon, and there's a young man going to preach at your church tonight." And he described me. He said, "He's going to have a blue suit on. He's going to have a blue tie with that suit. And he's going to have brown curly hair, and he's going to preach at your church tonight." And now remember, Thomas Coleman's got all this stuff going on from an accident that he was in. And Greer Hawkins told him, he said, "If you'll go up there and let that young man pray for you, when he lays his hands on you, you'll be healed." Now see, I walked in that service having no knowledge that that had happened. And so I didn't have any idea I was going to wear a blue suit, but I put on a blue suit that night. And when I walked in there, see, that one, I just put on a blue suit. It's just the one I put on. I walked in there in a blue suit. I preached. I didn't have nothing to do with healing. But after it was over, Thomas Coleman walked up to me, and he with great tears running down his face, he said, "Brother Hawkins called me before church. Do you remember him?" "Yeah, I do remember Greer Hawkins. He was our pastor." He said, if you would lay your hands on me, the Lord would heal me tonight." And I'm looking at this man. It's halfway mangled. I mean, his face, it's distorted. He can't bend his neck. I had no idea of that. And so the Lord quickened me, and he said, "Read to him Isaiah 53:5. I read it to him. "He was wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. With his stripes were healed." Now I asked him, "Does he believe it? Do you believe it?" He said, "Yes, Johnny, I believe it." And I said, "When I lay my hands on you, then receive your healing." I laid my hands on him, and his own testimony was God healed him right there. And to his testimony, every time I'd see him after that, he lived several years after that. After that, I'd say, "Now listen, are you healed, Brother Coleman? Are you healed? Are you healed?" He said, "Johnny, I ain't had no more neck pain and no more facial pain and no more headaches since you laid your hands on me. The Lord's my healer." That's how the gifts of the Spirit are supposed to work in the church. And that can happen any service, any time. All we have to do is be open to it. God wants to work things like that in your life all the time, but you have to be open to it. Praise God. So I'm believing God that you operate in the gifts of the Spirit. I'm believing God that you're energized in the Spirit and you become people that operate in miracle signs and wonders and blessing. You're miracle people. Do you believe that? All right, let's go on. Next trumpet sounds and we'll start drawing to a close. James, book of James. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. Thank God for the Spirit of God. Holy Ghost, anoint me fresh. Holy Ghost, not only live in me. Jesus said, "He that believeth on me, as the Scripture said, out of his belly shall flow." I want some flowing waters, don't you? The life is in the Spirit. The life is in the Spirit. All right, James chapter 5, first couple of verses, let me read. He says, "Go to now, you rich men, weep and howl, for your misery shall come upon you. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and your silver," talking about money here, "is cankered, and the rust of them shall be a witness against you, and shall eat your flesh as a fire. You have heaped treasure together for the last days. Behold, the hire of the laborers who have reaped down upon your fields, which is of you kept back by fraud, crieth, and the cries of them which have reaped are entered into the ears of the Lord of Sabaoth." And then in verse 13, "Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Any merry? Let him sing psalms. Any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church. Pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick." This is in the church. "And the Lord shall raise him up. If he hath committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much." The elders' ministry in the church. Thank God for leaders in the church. Thank God for leaders in the church. I thank God for Pastor Sears and those that are over me in the Lord. I thank God for them and all the fathers that have helped me and the mothers in Israel that have helped me. Thank God. Now this chapter is about, it starts out with money. Money's the problem. Now notice he says, "You rich men," he says, "you've heaped up treasure for yourself." Now he's talking about ministry and he's talking about leaders in the church of that day. And he said, what you've done is you have gotten money and you have become covetous in your approach to money. Now don't shout me down now. Money-motivated ministry will always end up in corruption. Money-motivated ministry will always end up in corruption. It's inevitable. Now notice what the Word of God says. He says, your gold and silver is cankered. And then he said, your riches will burn your flesh like a fire. Now that's a fire that's not holy. That's a fire that's ungodly. And there are preachers who lust for money. There are people that are in ministry and do ministry for money's sake. And he warns you here that money will burn your flesh like a fire. You can become covetous. You can have the spirit of covetousness in you. And that's not from God. It's not of God. It's not from the Lord. Jesus said, you freely receive, freely give. I ain't never charged anybody a dime to preach the gospel. And I never will. When bigger ministries call here, want me to come, they'll always say, what's your fee? I don't have one. Do you have a contract? No. If I'm coming to you, I'm going to come in covenant, and I expect you to do whatever God tells you to do. And even if you don't, God's going to do what he said. I'm believing God, not you. And for the vast majority of places I go, I'm treated well. I'm treated like royalty, and I'm thankful for that. And God's good, and I appreciate that. And I appreciate you all tithing and giving and helping take care of Teresa, and I appreciate that. Thank you. I do appreciate it. But you can't be motivated by money. You got to be motivated by love. And he warns these rich men. Notice he said, you howl. What do wolves do? They become wolves. And wolves are sheep eaters, and they devour sheep. And they're about it for money. And God forbid the day would ever come that I would treat one person different in this church than another because of what they give or don't give. We cannot be motivated by money. Money is not our source. God's our source. Now, let me balance that. We all know we need money in the church to run the church. You walked in here today, the power's on. Somebody paid the bill. High utility bills this month. We paid them. Thank God. You walk in here and the door's not padlocked. Somebody paid the mortgage. Thank God for the day the mortgage is gone. Thank God. Thank God. But you have to use some sense. You turned a water fountain on, got a drink of water. Somebody paid the water bill. You know, because they'll turn the church's water off just like they will yours. They don't care that we're a church, that we're open to fellowship. We believe the finished work. They care less. They'll come cut your lights off. They'll come cut the water off. They'll come padlock the door. The bank would take this from us if we didn't pay for it. That simple. So money can burn your flesh like a fire. And in leadership, you can't be motivated by money. This is not about boards and big wheels. Can I preach to you just a minute? When David tried to bring the Ark of the Covenant back, he put the Ark on boards and big wheels. And all of you know what a board and a big wheel is in church, right? A board is made up of the good businessmen in the church, and they become big wheels in the church. And through boards and big wheels, we tried to bring the presence of God in. And we've ended up fighting over whether we're going to give 50 bucks to a missionary or not. You're never going to get the presence back in the church with boards and big wheels. We're delivered from boards and big wheels. What God uses is sanctified men and women that can carry His presence on their shoulders, that carry His presence in their heart, that have His holy fire, His holy desire, and they ain't moved or motivated by nothing but His word and what He says. That's the way the ministry has to work. And so the method's wrong. Listen to what he says. He says, listen, these people that have been working and reaping, he says, you've taken wages from them and held back from them what's rightfully theirs. So here's what they did. They started taking from the people instead of giving to the people. I want to give something to you today. I want to give you Jesus. I want to give you the Word of God. I want to show you a new covenant. I want to give you the blood. And then I'll trust God to touch your heart to give back to me. But I'm not looking for you to give first. I want to give to you. I want to bless you. This is not about me exacting something from you. It's about giving something to you that He gave to me. Freely you have received. Freely give. That's the gospel. That's the gospel. And so anytime that we start looking at people to get something from them instead of give something to them, if you come in my presence, I want to give something to you. I want to bless you. I want you to leave my presence with more than you had when you came in my presence. That's the new covenant. If you come in my presence down, I want you up when you leave. If you come sick, I want you healed when you go. If you come weak, I want you strengthened when you leave. That's new covenant. It's not to get something from you, it's to give something to you. That's the method. Now notice, because of what happens here, they get into misery. And here's some very pointed thoughts. A lot of thought could be given here. He says, now is any afflicted? That has to do with discouragement. You know, if you get involved in this, if you get yourself involved in a money-motivated ministry and you get the method wrong and you start trying to give instead of receive, you give out of your receiving, you're going to get afflicted. That means to be discouraged and separated. You're going to get afflicted. And he tells you the answer for affliction is for you to pray. It's not for somebody else to pray for you. If you're discouraged, you need to pray. But I know I've been there myself. One of the hardest things in the world is to pray yourself when you are discouraged. But I want to encourage you today, pray. If you're struggling, pray. If you're struggling, call out to God. If you have to, just call out to God and just say Jesus if you have to. Because everybody in here, you've had your days. Everybody in here, you've had your moments. Everybody in here, you've had some times when you said, Lord, have mercy, and you've fallen and you're under the weight of what you're dealing with and the pressure and the pain, and I've been there, I know what that is, but you just say, Lord, and thank God He is faithful to deliver. I could testify, He delivered me out of a horrible pit. He put my feet on a solid rock. He put a new song in my mouth. Praise God, he delivered me. He's raised me up, praise God. I was in the pit. I was in the low place. I know what that is, but thank God, God delivers. He raises up. He'll deliver you. He does not want you depressed, oppressed, vexed in your mind. He wants you delivered and free and the spirit of power, love, and of a sound mind working in your mind, thought, and soul. And this is a very, very pointy question. Is any merry? I want to ask you a question. How in the world do you have to ask a New Covenant church, is anybody merry? I was looking at that last night and said, is any merry? Is any merry? A New Testament, born again, spirit-filled church. Anybody joyful in here this morning? Anybody glad they're saved? Let me show you what the Lord showed me. He said, turn to the prodigal son. So I was reading the story of the prodigal son. And you know, when that elder brother got back to the house, he heard the sound of music, laughter, and dancing. And you know what he had to say? He said, what meaneth this? He lived in that house. He lived in that house, but there was no music in him. There was no dancing in him. There was no laughter in him. And so when he heard it, it was a foreign thing. Open door, please hear me this morning. Don't let the praise of God become a foreign thing to you. Don't let laughter become a foreign thing to you. Don't let this be a strange sound, what we experienced this morning. Come on, let's praise God. Let's laugh in the spirit. Let's rejoice. Oh, praise God. I feel like preaching now. Hallelujah. The fatted calf was killed 2,000 years ago. The Lord Jesus Christ died, took your curse, took what you were, took your death, took your sin, took your curse and put it on a tree. He got up from the dead. There's a celebration in Father's house. Don't be distant. Don't be a stranger. Come on in. The party's going on. Father's blessing. Father's healing. Father's delivery. Father's bringing glory. Father has thrown a party and you're the guest of honor. Come on and celebrate the Father's house. Is any merry? I'm sorry, but he saved me. I remember what it was when I was down in 2010. I remember the hell I was in. He saved me. I'm sorry, but he saved me. He raised me up. He reached down into hell and got me out of it. Praise God. He set me free. Praise God, every chain is gone. I'm delivered. I'm free. I'm anointed. Praise God. It's my day. Hallelujah. It's him in me. And in 2014, I lay there with my pancreas tore all to pieces. They told me I'd be a hopeless, helpless diabetic. They told me I'd have an insulin pump. They told me that I'd have to live a very restricted life. Praise God, I'm alive. Praise God, no diabetes. Praise God, no insulin pump. Healed in my body, praise God. Is any merry? Come on, somebody make merry in the house of God. The table's spread. There's lamb on the table. There's wine on the table. There's water on the table. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo, praise God. Is any merry? That's ridiculous. Is any merry? Can't find one happy soul in the house of God. It's ridiculous. He saved you. He's forgiven you. If it hadn't been for the Lord on your side, you'd be dead. If it hadn't been for the Lord on your side, you might be in jail. Hadn't been for the Lord on your side, ain't no telling where you'd be. But he has delivered you. He kept you. He healed you. He saved you. Give him the glory. Is any merry in the church? Oh, come on, shout. Praise him this morning. Listen to me, listen to me. This elder brother was living in a palace. He had it made. He was sleeping on satin sheets. He was living with servants to wait on him hand and foot. He was there, and he missed everything in that house and everything the Father was. He missed it, and laughter and music and praise and celebration had become something he didn't even recognize it when he heard it. I don't ever want to live there. Is any merry? Open doors. Anybody merry in here this morning? Anybody glad your sins are gone? Anybody glad Jesus lives in you? Anybody glad you're in the new covenant? He saved you. He's blessed you. He's kept you. He's preserved you unto this day alive that he might bring forth his glory in your life. And notice that affliction, discouragement, and then a disconnect from praise and worship. That just bothers me. The elder brother said, "What meaneth this sound?" He did not recognize the sound of laughter, music, and dancing. Oh, praise God for this house. Praise God for blessing him and worshiping him. I don't ever want to become a foreigner and a stranger to the sound of his praise. In Jesus' name. I've got to close. Got to move quickly now. And then he said, "Is any sick among you?" Of course, that's disease, and that's decay in your body. So notice that they get discouraged. They get disconnected from praise in the church because of why? It's the ministry they're setting under. A lot of this has to do with the ministry. And you know what? Remember, good men, good fruit, bad report keep you out of your promise. God wants me to be a good man. He wants me to have good fruit, but he wants me to bring a good report. I told you last week, I'm not going to talk you down. I refuse to do it. You're the people of God. You're blessed and redeemed. You're filled and free. I heard the Lord say again and again this week, "The Lord shall increase you." He just kept prophesying to me all week long. "The Lord shall increase you. You more and more and your children, you are blessed of the Lord who made heaven and earth." Can't nothing stop that blessing. Can't anything get in its way. When he puts that and he invokes that over you, you are heirs according to the promise. You are the seed of Abraham according to Galatians 3. And that's God's word. Praise God. Praise God. "Is any sick among you?" Now we're down to the healing part of this. And he says, listen, if you're sick, you got anything wrong in your body, what does he say to do? Let him call for the elders of the church. Now, a lot of people won't call when they need help. I pastor a church, and sometimes I joke around, I shouldn't do this, probably need to quit it, but I say, you know, pastor's last one to know. And you know, my words are probably being used against me. I should say, by the Holy Ghost, I know first. Probably need to change my perspective, but in a jokey manner, so-and-so's in the hospital. Really? I didn't know that. Why didn't they call? I have not one time ever been asked to go anywhere that I didn't go. Now, there have been some places I didn't go, and somebody said, "Wonder why I didn't go?" I didn't know. You know, I can walk on water as long as I know where the rocks are. You do understand the concept that I'm not omniscient, right? As long as I know where the rocks are, man, I can stay up here good, but man, you... Yeah, so-and-so did that. They did? When did they do that? Let him call for the elders of the church. If you are struggling in your physical body, call for the elders of the church. I'm going to get the elders up here in a minute. If you got anything wrong in your body, I brought some more. We do it just like God said. Smith Wigglesworth carried a bottle of oil all the time. There ain't no power in this oil. It's just olive oil, but it represents the precious Holy Spirit. Listen to me. Let them anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. The ministry, praise over him in the name of Jesus. And sins are dealt with, and there's a cleansing and washing. And then, thank God, there is a manifestation of healing. The prayer of faith, the prayer of faith shall save the sick. Save, heal, deliver, restore to health the sick, those wounded and mortally struggling. The prayer of faith shall save the sick. Can I have an amen? And then finally he says, now watch it multiply. Now you turn, because remember, now they're fussing and fighting in the book of James. He says, now you turn and start loving one another, and then you start praying for one another that you may be healed. And it starts multiplying. Wouldn't it be great if people just started praying for one another in here, and signs and wonders and miracles just break out on the left and right, and healing begins to happen. If you got anything wrong with your physical body, if you're discouraged today, you need help, then the elders are going to come up here and they're going to anoint you with oil and pray for you. You don't have to leave the way you came in Jesus' name. Praise God. Now stand with me in Jesus' name. I've gone as far as I need to. Last verse. Psalms 133. Look at this. Behold how good and pleasant it is that we dwell together in unity. We dwell together in unity. It's like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down, this oil that ran on Aaron's beard, went down to the skirts of his garment. Look at verse 3. Look at this. The dew, you know that the king's favor is due. It's like the king's favor on Hermon and the dew that descended upon Zion. For there the Lord commanded the blessing. That blessing is Jesus. Jesus is under command. even there for life evermore. Jesus, the way, the truth, the life. He's under command in Jesus' name. See, the truth is, God's put some help in here for us. The gifts of the Spirit are here to operate to help us. The elders of the church and the people that are leaders in the church are here to help you. Please, I just beseech you by the word of the Lord, don't go without getting help if you need help. Now, I have to admit, there have been times maybe perhaps that I didn't ask for help, but for the most part, when I get in trouble, I ain't shy about asking for help. When I was laying in that bed up there, I remember Patricia came to see me one night, and I was having a really rough night, really rough day that day, and I said, "Woman of God, put your hands on me right here and pray and command me to get out of this bed." And she did it. I wasn't shy to ask Trish Clemens to pray for me. I said, "Come on, put your hands on me. I need your help." You know, because spiritually I wasn't hitting on much. You ever been there where, yeah, just pain in my body, pain, just not hitting on much. And I asked her, she put her hands on me and prayed, "Thank God for help." So, Father, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, thank you. We hear these sounding trumpets today. Thank you that you put the gifts of the Spirit in the church and we covet earnestly the best gifts. I thank you this is an anointed church. It's a Holy Ghost filled church. It's a spiritual church that moves in spiritual gifts in Jesus' name. And I thank you, Lord, and I praise you, Lord, that we are not people that are motivated by money. I will not, God, if I am, please check my heart. Thank you, Lord. It's not, and the methods have to be right to give first, to just keep giving and giving and giving and trust you to give it back. And then I thank you, Lord, that we're delivered from misery. This misery that was in the book of James, I thank you. If there's any afflicted in here, we pray. If there's any merry, then, Lord, we just begin to give praise and thanksgiving. Said, let him sing. Let him sing songs. So we just sing today. We bless you today, Lord. We just shout victory today. If there's any sick, let him call for the elders of the church in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord. I thank you. I thank you for supernatural work in this church, supernatural blessing, supernatural power, supernatural manifestations in this church in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, you that meet with me and I call you elders, come on up here, stand with me in Jesus' name. Jim and Wayne and Dreema and come on, Richard. Come on, Teresa. Come on. Sheila, if you'd go, and maybe Mariah, you could help her. Thomas, you come on. You're going to lead. Here's some elders. Pastor Gary, yeah, come on up. And if you need help today, listen, if you're struggling, you need help, I want you to get these people to pray for you. We're going to anoint you with oil and pray for you. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to the church. I'm going to go back there and pastor. I'm going to hug people's neck as they're leaving and love people because I'm not the only one in here that can do things. If y'all are dependent on me, you're worse off than you know. Praise God. And I wept last night and I said, oh God, there are people in our church that just, some are worried about jobs, some are worried about family. If you have any of that going on, get them to pray for you in Jesus' name. I'm going to pray. And then those of you that need prayer, come this way. Those of you that have to leave, I'll be at the back door. I want to hug your neck and bless you. I love you, Open Door. You're a great church. You're great people. Don't forget the ladies' tea party today. I'm believing God, this church has radically changed today. I'm believing I'm radically changed today. When I saw that last night, is any Mary, man, I cried, I wept over here. My tears ran hot. Is any Mary? God, what an indictment. What an indictment. Lord, in Jesus' name, Father, thank you. Lord, meet the needs of your people now. Lord, we give today freely. We give to them in Jesus' name. We give freely. We give freely. We give freely. We give freely in Jesus' name. Their needs are met, and I thank you for it, Lord. I give you praise and honor in Jesus' name. Thomas, come on, take the oil. You anoint them with oil, and then you guys gather around. If you need prayer, come this way. If not, you're dismissed with the blessing of the Lord on your life. I'm going to stand at the back door. I love you, Open Door. God bless you. Watching by internet, God bless you in Jesus' name.